Hi, I'm Ron.
And I'm Don.
And this is the Ron and Don Show. Thank you for joining us today. Our topic today is wood, brick, and stone specific to restaurant exteriors. Our subject matter expert today is, again, Keith Moore of U.S. Exteriors. Keith, we're really glad you're here.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate it. U.S. Exterior, we're into our 20th year this year, and we actually specialize in exterior building envelopes, get into different types of materials with those, and we'll do anything restoration, repairs, all the way up to diagnostic solutions.
When we talk about exteriors, particularly where we have wood, brick, and stone, particularly when we're talking about wood, what do we need to know to keep that from falling apart and turning into dust?
Some of the things with wood that we got to think about today that maybe weren't prevalent 30 years ago or so is in about 1979, the U.S. government decided to regulate the amount of preservatives we were putting into woods. Reason why was wood wasn't breaking down in landfills. So as they started to remove the preservatives out of the products, what we've started to notice and seen over the past 30 years is wood has the tendency to decay faster and rot faster than what it used to. Secondary to that is we're actually using more softwoods today than we've ever used before. We're using engineered woods, so you're going to have a lot more finger joints and trim that we never used to have. So when we go back into the 50s, we had a lot of hardwood growth. We had a lot of solid wood pieces going up around the outside of a building. Well, as time marched on, we've done different technologies that have caused the wood to actually break down a little more. And the one thing we got to remember is wood is an organic. So water attacks it, and it becomes food for various microorganisms that cause the wood rot. So when it comes to preserving wood, the best thing you can do is have a stellar maintenance program. And that means that you're probably going to be looking at the outside of your facility every 12 months and really looking at how the wood's holding up. You know, for us, we look at it, if you have a piece of peeling paint and it's on an 8-inch board, but it may only be 3 to 4 inches in diameter, you really need to take that whole board and take and provide maintenance to it. And how are you gonna do that? Well, it's all gonna come down to the prep. So you're gonna remove any of the peeling paint, we're gonna sand it, we're gonna reprime it, and we're gonna paint it. And I would do it to that entire piece because you really don't wanna see a lot of spot repairs on the building. And then what you'll notice if you do spot repairs is it'll actually start to fail around the repair now because we didn't keep it on the same building cycle. Maintenance to wood, it's going to take you a while to keep up on it. You're going to spend more in the beginning, but on the long term, you're going to prevent a lot of the wood rot that can show up around the.
What about some of the synthetic products out?
There's some awesome synthetic products out there today. They're made with plastic composites. They look like wood, but they don't act like wood. Because they're inert and they have no organics in them, they can last 10, 15, 20 years. They're still going to require a little bit of a maintenance program because we're going to have to seal them at the edges like we would any other wood piece. But our overall maintenance long-term is going to be a lot less because we're not going to have as much replacement with them.
And then the other problem with woods is keeping sealants around them. Sometimes it isn't the paint necessarily blistering off, but the expansion and contraction can break the sealants.
Exactly. One of the things we want to pay attention to when we're actually doing maintenance to the wood is the perimeter sealants around them. Wood is typically butted up against something, whether it's a siding, maybe like a hardy board siding, or something along those lines. That intersection needs to be properly sealed. And we need to pay attention to the sealants that we're using because a lot of those sealants require a paint coat on top of them to be effective. But a lot of times we're not doing that. We're painting. We're putting the sealant on, we're walking away. Well, when we walk away without putting that protective layer on top of the sealant, we're actually given a perfect opportunity for it to fail. And it's generally gonna fail in about 12 to 24 months. So that nice, beautiful paint job that you spent lots of money on for your facility is gonna fail prematurely because the paint specs or the caulking specs in this case weren't necessarily followed.
Well, okay, so let's tie all that together. We've talked about exterior wood surfaces, the need for an ongoing maintenance program. We're tying it into painting. Unfortunately, I think the real world is nobody pays attention to the exterior wood surfaces and the needed maintenance until such time as it's time to paint.
I think that's a big case that we see, and I think it needs to go really into your annual checklist. You need to really pay attention as a facility manager. You're walking the building, and you know, really ideally, you'd walk it in the spring and you'd walk it in the fall. And on your checklist is to really look at the wood and examine it. There was an article in Facilitator a few years ago that we wrote that it takes a village. Well, it also works on training your store managers to look for those things too and report them to you. You know, they're at their property every day and they can notice when we start to have failing sealant or we have wood decay happening and things like that.
When you're looking at water migration, we also can get insects going into the wood. What's the best prevention for that?
A good maintenance program, because what the insects are looking for is food, and wet wood is the biggest attractor to carpenter ants and other type of pests. So they're finding entry points in there to get to the wood and start having lunch, basically.
Of course, keeping the mulch away from the building kind of helps.
Yes, keeping all your landscaping away. We always say if you can keep your bushes trimmed about 12 inches away from the exterior of the building, you're in really good shape. If you can keep the mulch from being piled up against the base of the wall where you have nothing but moisture and that moisture sitting on the outside, and really that's going to apply to any exterior cladding that we're dealing with.
Well, I don't think we would finish the topic of exterior wood without talking about the products. So why don't you run us through the sealants, the paints, where do we get all this stuff?
So one of the best places, because really paints with wood and the sealants that go with them are very regionalized. There are really good products that work in the South that aren't going to work so well in the North and vice versa. One of the things we recommend is to get with a manufacturer's paint rep, generally on the architectural side, have them meet you at your property. They're more than willing to do that. They're going to give you the best education as to what's going to work best and long-term for your facility.
I have taken advantage of that for a number of years with one particular paint manufacturer, and they will literally write a 7 or 8 page protocol for the steps and process to go through refinishing of the exterior of a building.
We do it because we work around the country. We bring them in basically in every different region that we have to do maintenance or look at the property and find out what's going on. You know, a lot of times it's, why is this paint peeling off continuously? And they can make a recommendation for a better primer, a different primer. But yeah, they're very good at coming out and helping you diagnose the problems you've got. And they're really good if you ask them to help write a generic spec that can go across two or three of the major paint brands if you don't want to be tied into a specific brand.
It's a whole lot different than running to the big box retail and buying 4 or 5s of exterior paint.
It really is. And I know we all like to look at handyman services and things like that. But really, if you start really looking at a good commercial painting contractor, they're also going to be a great value to you in this process. And if you have them and your local paint manufacturers rep together as a team, you can really end up with a win-win situation.
Left, right.
Exactly.
So let's move on to bricks and stone. Let's talk about how you're going to deal with those.
Well, the one thing when we're looking at brick that we really need to be aware of is when brick comes out of the kiln, it's the smallest it's ever going to be in its life. It's a clay product. So now we're going to introduce it into the environment. And as it's introduced into the environment, natural rains and everything are going to hit it. That brick is going to grow microscopically. As it grows over time, though, a lot of times what you're going to see is cracking or spalling or the failed mortar joints. Basically, that comes down to the brick itself.
Define spalling for our...
Spalling would be, we get water into the brick, we normally would get a freeze, and then part of that brick is going to, the face of it's going to pop off. A lot of times we can define water entry into our system with brick. The nice thing about it is you'll get efflorescence. And efflorescence is the salts and the alkaloids that leach out of the mortar and the brick itself as we get water into the building. So it's generally a pretty good indication that we have something else going on that we need to look into. It could be failed flashing, failed sealant, failed window fenestration. It could be a lot of other components that are happening. So we really need to pay attention to that white chalkiness that shows up on our brick and mortar. But let's say we do get a brick and we do get it cracked. We have a couple of ways to address it. If it's a straight vertical crack, you can actually ask the contractor to grind that crack out and repoint it in place, okay? The other thing that we can do is actually remove the brick and put in a new brick. Gonna be a little more costly. Long-term, it'll probably give you the best return, but we also need to identify what caused it to crack. Because generally bricks don't just crack. We generally have some compressive nature happening at that point, so we need to look into it. When we get into tuck pointing, we need to know what type of mortar we want to use. High tensile strength, low tensile strength, that type of stuff. If it's available, I would go back to your original construction documents and see what was specified and go with a similar type mortar for your specifications when you're going back to tuck point.
Unless it goes back to the 1950s, in which time there was one mortar.
Exactly, exactly. And in today we have multiple mortars.
Right.
So then it's gonna be picking what's best for the situation
right.
that we're dealing with. But really, if we're gonna tuck point, we're gonna have to grind it out. It's gonna be noisy at the restaurant, so it's something you're probably gonna wanna do after hours or before hours. OSHA has come out with a lot of new standards today regarding silica dust, so you need to watch because they are putting a lot of that responsibility on the specifying person. So if you're in the facilities and you're not specifying dust control, they can actually come back and hit you for it too, as well as the contractor that's not practicing it. So things to keep in mind when you're doing it. But we want to grind out about 3/8 of an inch of the mortar, and then we want to lay in a new mortar bed.
What about lick and stick type products, you know, the bricks, the stone, the man-made and natural?
So the easiest way to think about all of the cultured stones that we have out there or thin-set bricks is really they are a new type of finish that's going on almost a conventional stucco system. So you're going to have your brown coat, you're going to have your wire mesh and your sheathing and your waterproof layer there. So we're adding these products to that as we build out. Now, things to consider, if we're in the north, we don't want to use a stacked stone that doesn't have any mortar joints. Water gets in it, it freezes, it pops, and it pops all the stone off of it. We want to look at those products that have mortar joints in them because we want to keep the water on the outside of the stone. We get in the southern states, it's not that big of a deal. We don't get that freeze-thaw so much to where we're losing it. But all of them need to be treated in a very similar way as to a conventional masonry. You're gonna get some cracking, you're gonna get some stones that pop off. They need to be, again, put back on and basically maintained in a very similar fashion.
So any other tips for long-term maintenance of stone surfaces?
Try to stay away from water repellents that you're gonna put on the outside of the surfaces. One, they're gonna change the color of your building. Some of them are siloxane based. If they're siloxane based and it gets on your glass or anything else, it's going to etch it on the building. But once you start a water repellency program on your masonry, it is an ongoing maintenance issue. It is not a one and done type thing. Most of those repellency products are designed to self-deteriorate after about 4 or 5 years. So you're going to make a continued maintenance program. You're better off to address what's causing the moisture issue as opposed to putting a Band-Aid on it. But overall, it's just like our wood. We want to make for sure that we're looking at the building on a regular basis.
Keith, I want to thank you. That is some terrific information. I appreciate you coming here today. Thank you, and thank you, U.S. Exteriors.
And I also thank you. We've been working together for years, and you've been a wonderful contractor for me.
I appreciate it. Thanks, guys.
Thanks for being here. I'm Ron.
I'm Don.
And I'm Keith.
And this is the Ron and Don Show. Thank you for joining us today. Please subscribe.